the popularity of vampire films and so on points to something, points to the fact that the category of living dead, or to use another example, untote, the undead, with the precise connotation that this term has in Stephen King and horror literature, neither dead nor alive, but a kind of a life in death itself, that it is a crucial category today, not only in imaginary, but precisely in medical ethics, bioethics, or even more precisely in biopolitics. I think that, for example, the category which is today most popular in new political thinking, the category of Homo sacer, reintroduced by or resuscitated by Giorgio Agamben, Homo sacer is precisely in a way the living dead of the social space. The one who, while biologically alive, is reduced, deprived of his or her political life. And it would be interesting to posit as the opposite of Homo sacer, kind of inversion of it, the very strange case of, you remember, half a year ago now, I think, the Terence Iago case in the United States, where a woman was dead in all the senses of the word, just not biologically dead. Her brain didn't work, she was reduced to just a, not even animal, but vegetative state, and you remember probably how the entire American establishment, Congress, President, met, take measures, should they perform an euthanasia because she was only kept vegetatively alive, mechanisms. What I'm saying is that there is something about mere life, bloßes Leben, protecting mere life, which is the sensitive point today. And I think that we should not simply reject this category. In a way, a part, crucial part of every radical emancipatory politics today should be that, in a way, you accept this position of the living dead. Gilles Deleuze wrote somewhere that a truly great art offers us an inhuman perspective, not inhuman in the sense of torturing or what, but inhuman in the sense that we can, even if it shows people, it shows them the way they would have been seen, individuals who are the topic of art, seen with a gaze which looks at them in a way from a position which is before or after humanity, an inhuman gaze. Now, you will say this is science fiction, it's not possible. No, I think it is possible, but in a very precise way. This inhuman gaze does not mean gaze outside of humanity, but the gaze from from the inhuman core, the inhuman element of humanity itself, something which is inhuman as inherent to humanity. Let me introduce some philosophical order in it before we go further. The philosophical reference here, of course, is Immanuel Kant. His crucial distinction in Critique der reinen Vernunft between negative and unendliches, infinite judgment, urteil. Negative judgment only negates a predicate. Infinite judgment asserts a non-predicate. Now, you will say it's the same. It's not. Let me demonstrate it to you. Negative judgment simply means, for example, let's take precisely our example. You are dead, or I am dead. Negative judgment negates a predicate. I am not dead. This simply means I am alive. No mystery here. But if you do not negate the predicate, but assert a non-predicate, that is to say, if instead of saying he isn't dead, you say he is undead, something totally different emerges. This, if you say, oh, he is undead, this doesn't mean simply he is alive. It means he is the living dead. It means he is alive while dead. This terrifying intermediate state is not just something imagined. It has a certain ethical reality. When do we... So, you got my point. It's the dimension of deadness inherent in certain radical experiences to life itself. When life gets too intense, too traumatic, the only way to survive is to turn into a living dead. This brings us to catastrophes. To give you an example, a very primitive one, for me, what would have been this view of humanity as from through inhuman gaze? Let's turn to the catastrophe whose fifth anniversary we were celebrating a couple of weeks ago, the 11th of September. Imagine, and maybe they exist, but they would probably have been too traumatic. Imagine that they would have discovered that some of the passengers in the planes which hit the World Trade Center, that the passengers there had video cameras, and that they recorded the last moments, precisely the plane hitting the Twin Towers, or the other way around, that some people who later died, we would be able to see, maybe, I don't know, there were some security live cameras. And I think that even if the United States authorities possess these documents, in a way, although I'm a great critic of United States politics, I can understand them if they just set them apart, don't show them. This would be seeing human reality with inhuman eyes. You enter a prohibited territory, in a way. Because even when we are in this kind of position of already living dead, having no time to live, we usually escape into falsity. Here, I would like to give you an example of this falsity. If you saw the film United 93 about the plane which crashed down, or if you read about the fate of those passengers, you know that many of them phoned their, what they did, how they used the last minutes when they more or less knew that they will die. They called their nearest relatives, telling them, my wife, my husband, my children, my mother, whatever, I love you. I will die, but I love you. Now, some people, like the English writer Martin Amis, made this Christian Paulinian, in the sense of Paulus, St. Paul, point how, you see, Paul was right. What really matters is love. When things are for the real, you know you will die, you just have seconds, minutes to live. Everything can fall apart, the universe, your world, catastrophe, the thing that matters at that, literally, at a gunpoint, not personally. Although, if I take power, you would need, I can imagine you with like 2 years of re-education camp would serve you well, but that's another story, okay. But then, the thing that really matters is love. I pathetically disagree with you. I think that there is absolutely nothing authentic in those desperate moments when you call, oh, my wife, I'm there, I will die, I love you. I think you are simply totally scared and you desperately want to do something correct, settle the accounts. I can well imagine, and in a more problematic book on September 11th, I read about it. I can well imagine a much more problematic example of a husband who did this and it was proven for him that he was treating his wife like crazy and wanted to divorce her. But at that point, dying called his wife, I love you, and so on and so on. I think this precisely is not accepting it. Now, I will tell you something horrible, which is not a joke. Then, when I presented this idea at a talk in the United States, people asked me, okay, but tell me, what would be for you an authentic act in this sense? What would you have done? I said, of course, on condition that what I will say now is true. about my relations with my wife.